that you were thinking it, so I'm just going to mention it. I'm sure when you heard the reading of John's Gospel from the 11th chapter about Lazarus, you says, what in the world does this have to do with Easter? Did any of you think that? You were expecting the John 20, and so I thought I'd throw that in. But I've been doing a series of sermons on the I Am sayings of Jesus, and on Easter Sunday, it's probably a good Sunday to use the one, I am the resurrection and the life. You might think they don't go together, but they do. Because John 11 is a precursor, as a part of what's going to take place in John 20, as a part of the resurrection. Story happens to be about Lazarus, and you know bits and pieces, but what you may not know is that there's some words in particular important earlier in John 11 that you need to hear. These words are words that come in verse 4, what it says. When Jesus heard that Lazarus was sick, he said, "This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." Ta-da! Light bulb. Light bulb. Then in verses 14 and 15, Jesus said, after he first said that Lazarus was asleep, and they said, well, Lord, maybe he can use a good rest. You know, that's a good thing. And then Jesus says, Lazarus is dead. And for your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe, but let us go to him. We sometimes don't put those together, especially with John 20, but it's very important because following that part, when Jesus went, it says that Mary, or Martha, came out first to meet Jesus and said, "Teacher, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Jesus then said the words, "I am the resurrection and life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die." And then Jesus says these words, which are words for us again today, is, do you believe this? Do you believe this? And Martha says, yes, Lord, I know that on the resurrection day, he will rise. And if you're like I am, sometimes when I would read that, I would say, what's this about resurrection? The time we hear about resurrection is when Jesus is resurrected. But it wasn't a new idea. It didn't begin with Jesus. It began earlier. Daniel in the Old Testament says, those who are asleep and those who rest in the dust will one day be raised. Some to eternal life. And then a part of that is that the Jewish folks had a part of that understanding of resurrection, even though they didn't fully understand it. Even the Pharisees, the keepers of the law, understood this. It was something that they believed, but they had never experienced the reality of it. So Jesus goes on to share as a part of that. And then Mary comes out, and Mary says the same thing that Martha says. If you read that scripture, it says, Lord, if you had been here, our brother would not have died. Mary was a little bit slower in going, as Jesus was slow in going there. There were others with Mary. There were those who, if you understand a part of the Jewish tradition, those who are professional mourners. Not just family and a few friends show up, but other folks who are paid to mourn. So Mary starts weeping after she says to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Mary starts weeping, and guess what? All of the mourners start weeping. If you read in some of the translations, it says that Jesus became a bit unsettled. Basically, he was upset. Same thing that Jesus faced in many other situations with his disciples. Do you not understand? So then he says, show me where he is. And they say, well, come and see. And he walks and he has the stone rolled away from Lazarus' tomb. He's been dead 4 days. And they say he probably stinks now. And then all of a sudden Jesus says, Lazarus, come forth. And Lazarus comes out with his grave clothes on. And Jesus says, unbind him and let him go. Think of those words as a part of that. But the story of Lazarus is really not about Lazarus. Did you know that? It's really not about Lazarus. It's about Mary and Martha and those who live with death. Jesus is saying, I am the resurrection and I am life. And there's not a one of us who at some time or another in our lives have not lived with death in some way. Basically, there are all kinds of Good Fridays in our lives. There's that loss of a spouse. There's a loss of a parent. There's a loss of a child. There's a loss of a close friend. And they're Good Fridays. But as Tony Campolo had preached as a part of that, talking about it, says, it's Friday, but Sunday's coming for those of us of faith, that we have a lot of Good Fridays. But on this day, this Easter morn, we reclaim and remember again that Christ has given us a promise that there's hope for the future. Do you know what the hardest word to understand in the dictionary is? It's the word hopeless. I've heard that several times in my lifetime. I've heard it at times with a family member when a doctor would say, there's not anything else that we could do for them, and says, it looks like the situation is hopeless. I've been with families, and some of you may have heard those words as a part of that. But let me tell you, mark it in your mind and write it on your heart today. For the Christian, there is no such word as hopeless. Death has a sting to it. It's that part of life that we experience sometimes and we don't like it. But a part of that is that death has a finality. But Jesus made a promise. He said, if you take my life, in 3 days, I will rise again. And Jesus, on resurrection morn, put hope back in life forever for that which is eternal. And it's that promise that we hold on to, that we share. And sometimes in the midst of all that, we don't fully understand all that God is saying. But Jesus says, do you believe this? One writer has said at that point, you can look at it, but take the word believe and put the word trust. And a Catholic bishop said there is a big difference between believing and trusting. Do you believe this? Do you trust these words? Jesus said, I will rise. And an empty tomb says that he kept his word. He did rise. We share in the midst of that and also recognize that when we read that passage of Scripture, Jesus, resurrection is important, but it's not the key word. It's not that he is the life. That's not the key word. The key word is believe. And we hold to that. The church, through the centuries, your ancestors, those who've come before, those could go back generation and generation, there are a number of them who've heard the same words you're hearing this day. And we proclaim it so that future generations can hear it, because that is our hope. It's not an empty tomb, it's a living Savior. He's in the world today just as he was in that day. When we think about those things, we look at the promises that Jesus made. If you want to go back and just kind of put your framework, and I hate that this is on Sunday when I get to mention this, but I want you to go back and read Psalm 31. Psalm 31 is the words that Jesus knew and lived by and held on even in the midst of his crucifixion. He says, look at all these things. I'm despised. I'm rejected as a part of that. But he says, Father, my hope, my trust is in you. Jesus lived in that relationship with the Father and calls us to live in that relationship. When we think about those words, we can be reminded that Christ is our hope. And for those of us who've experienced those Good Fridays in our life, it's easy to crave the things the way they used to be, because sometimes, I hope I'm not stepping on too many people's toes, but for some, I will be. Sometimes, even as Christians, we think more resuscitation than we do resurrection. Jesus really didn't do Lazarus any favors, did he? You're saying, what do you mean? Didn't do Lazarus any favors. He raised Lazarus from the dead and brought him back, but guess what? Lazarus would die again. And if you read a little bit further following this 11th chapter, you'll find out that Caiaphas, the high priest, was already upset with Jesus. And now Jesus has raised Lazarus from the dead. So he says, we've got to put this Jesus to death. And the only way we can do this so that Lazarus doesn't run off and tell somebody else and everybody starts believing in Jesus, we also have to put Lazarus to death. You know, if you commit a crime, at least from what we see on TV shows, and that's not reality sometimes, if you commit a crime, you can't have any witnesses if you're going to get away with it. And even the priests knew that you can't just take Jesus' life for what he's done. You also have to take the witnesses away. And Lazarus was included as a part of that. But with Mary and Martha, that understanding a part of what God was doing in the midst of that. And that resuscitation is that we want things back. Really, it's kind of bringing back to life. But in the midst of all that, what it is we want things the way they were. Am I wrong? We want a spouse back. We want a child back. We want a job back. We want our marriages back. And yet sometimes that's just a resuscitation to bring those persons back to life. But Jesus talks about a resurrection. He doesn't just change things. He transforms things and gives us new possibilities. Hear this. People of faith, at least in some level, or you wouldn't be here today. Jesus lives on both sides of the grave. And with that, you ought to say, hallelujah. Thanks be to God. Jesus, who carried the weight as a part of that, even if thinking that the stone was rolled away and there was an empty tomb, I like to think, and some have said this before, and I borrowed some of it. I don't mind telling you I borrowed some of it, that sometimes, you remember me talking about the leaves sometimes that we see that are just kind of waving like that all by themselves, you can't tell. People say that's the wind doing it. Well, on Easter morn, the resurrection, the stone started kind of trembling around a little bit. And the stone sent the word to the soil, and the soil sent it out to the roots of the trees, and the trees, and all of a sudden, in anticipation, they started waving because they knew that Jesus was about to burst forth from the grave and conquer death, hell, and the grave for all of us. Because then he said, because I live, you shall live also. Whoever believes in me, let me repeat it, whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Not necessarily physically, but to live eternally. Because that morning when Jesus stepped out, forever came into being, and that which is eternal came into being. Death has that finality, but those of us who are in Christ know that there's a promise of a future. Death does not give you any promises of anything. But Jesus did. And what it says to me is that the power of God, you want to know about the power of God? Some of the theologians have said earlier that Jesus was very specific when he called Lazarus forth from the tomb. He said, Lazarus. Because Jesus held the power of life. He said, Lazarus, come forth. And if he had just said, come forth, the whole cemetery would have emptied out. Jesus had that much power, and he had the power to be able to overcome death. But he also had the power to overcome sin. Now I want you to think about this. And I think about it often. Jesus gets personal. And he says, I died for your sins. Got that? And then you can turn to the one next to you and say, Jesus died for my sins, and he died for your sins. And take everyone that's gathered someplace in worship today, and those even who are not in worship, who've not understood this story, Jesus died for their sins. The weight of the sins of the world were on Jesus, and even the sin of all the world, all that we've committed and that which we may commit in the future, was in that grave, and it could not hold him. He rose as victor. And yet, for those who don't know anything about Easter, I said to folks, and they caught me in it again this morning. I told them at 8:30, I said, you know, everybody says happy Easter. Well, let me let you in on a little clue. A lot of folks can say happy Easter, and they have no idea what you and I are talking about when we say happy Easter. They might be thinking of the Easter bunny, a bunny that lays eggs. But guess what? Easter's kind of weird too, if you think about it. You remember the Friday when Jesus was crucified? What do we call that? It's called Good Friday. Now, does that make sense? Christ is crucified. On Easter Sunday morning, and I let the cat out of the bag with someone back in the back. When I was serving in Irvington, we had Easter sunrise service. Can you make sense of that? To wake up at sunrise, there's something about sunrise. Now, if you're like me, sometimes morning comes too early. But every once in a while when I'm up and I see the sunrise, and I've been waiting for that the last couple of weeks because I like to walk early in the morning, it's a whole lot easier to walk in the sunrise and not walk with the danger of Madisonville streets. You know, in the dark, even if you're on the sidewalk, any place, it's dangerous. But when the sun rises, and especially on this day when the S-O-N rises, don't things change? After a cloudy and a rainy day, and the next morning when you see the sunshine, doesn't it change something in you? And we go at that point, and we go there, and it's a sunrise in the midst of that. And yet, sometimes, as I said, when I was in Irvington, we had our service in the cemetery. Because when you go to a cemetery on Easter, you don't go to mourn. Isn't that right, Mont? You don't go to mourn. You go to dance. Because Jesus kept his promises. It's that sense of our knowing. It's recognizing, even though it's weird, it's not to those of us who are people of faith. Because Easter has a way of defining us. That's, you know, look at that. You know, Good Friday, it's not good. Holy Week, now we don't like it because sometimes we think more of the resuscitation instead of the resurrection. We don't like to come on Holy Week and, you know, think what you will. I'm just going to state it as I think it is. If I'm wrong, then tell me. A lot of folks don't come Holy Week because it's depressing. We don't like the suffering. We don't like hearing about the betrayal. We don't like hearing about the denial or seeing the gory things of crucifixion that Christ went through for you and for me. And if I'm honest with myself, I'm not saying about you, I'm honest with myself, there's always a little bit of betrayal in my life if I don't guard against it. There's always a little denial in my life if I don't guard against it. There's always that part of the crucifixion is somebody else, but don't cause me any pain. Don't cause me to have to look on the inside. But dear friends, as several great theologians and great preachers have said, you can't have the crown on Easter Sunday unless you first had the cross on Good Friday. That baby born at Christmas so long ago, that baby who was called Jesus, if Easter had not happened, that baby named Jesus, born to Joseph and Mary, would have just been another statistic of births that occurred in Bethlehem. If it had just been a cross and Jesus died on the cross without a resurrection, Jesus would have just been identified as another revolutionary in the Jewish world, and most folks would probably never have heard of him or cared anything about his name. But we as the church know that there was an empty tomb. The resurrection that defines us, Easter defines us, but it also inclines us, because at that time there was that sense of hopelessness in the world. Everything was on a downward spiral. People could not look up, and many of them had given up. Kyle preached this morning at our sunrise service, and he said, recent statistics say, even with political campaigns, it has nothing to do with political campaigns, but he says most people have anxiety and worry in their lives, and guess what? Christians have that as well. But resurrection causes us to lean in, because in that spark of hope with the Christ resurrected, our hearts began to have hope. We're called into a new way of life. We're called to love and to know the experience of grace. We're called to experience and we're called to share that word, because Christ is our hope. When we think about those things as a part of our life, the other things that does is that Easter refines us. It makes us different. It changes our heart. It changes our attitude. It calls us from a life that's self-centered into being one who reaches out and thinks about others. And if you look at the life of Jesus, that's what you'll see. It was not just in his life, but it was even after his resurrection. He invested himself in his disciples and gave them the call to continue to proclaim that message. So we don't say just Happy Easter. We say Christ is risen, and Christ is risen indeed. Easter can mean a lot of things, but it really is about the Christian faith. It's not just about the newness of spring. It's a reminder of some of those things for us, but it's about an empty tomb and a risen Savior who lives in us today. It was Palm Sunday, and a Sunday school teacher was sharing with her Sunday school class that she wanted them to take the little plastic eggs and put something that had to do with new life inside it and bring it back on Easter Sunday. Sure enough, that's what they did. Everybody brought in their egg and they put them in a basket, and she began to open them up, and she looked at one and she opened it up, and there was a flower. How appropriate with flowers here. Flowers, it was a sign of new life. She opened up another egg, and there was a plastic butterfly that was a sign of new life there. And then she pulled open one of the eggs, and it was empty. And she thought of one particular student who maybe didn't understand the instructions. He was a special needs child. She wasn't sure that he understood a part of it, and so she very quietly closed the egg back up and put it back in the basket. And then from the back of the room, this little boy raised his hand and said, "Teacher, teacher, what about my egg?" She knew she had to reach back down and pick it up, and she picked it up, and she said, "Stephen, it's empty." He said, "And guess what? So was the tomb on Easter Sunday morning." He knew about the power of the resurrection. There's new life that's all around us, but also a symbol of our faith is an empty tomb and a risen Savior. We can have confidence. Confidence in knowing, and if we believe this, we ought to believe the other things that Jesus said. What Jesus said was true, and if he can rise from the dead and keep his promises, you better believe he can keep his other promises as well. It also gives us confidence that when we're in relationship, when we believe and when we trust, that we know that Christ is ever present with us, but it also gives us the promise that one day Christ will come again, and those of us who believe, even though we die, yet shall we live. Because those who live and believe and trust in Him will never die. All seemed hopeless, but Christ brings hope. Hope for today and hope for tomorrow. Here's the big question. Do you believe? Do you trust? If so, and if you live that today and tomorrow and seek to live it every day, then the promise is those who live and believe and trust in me shall never die. Someone will say words over all of us one day. But remember that death does not have the final word. A risen Savior has the final word. And He lives. And Easter people are called to raise their voices. The song that we're going to sing is hymn number 304, Easter People, Raise Your Voices. And it's not to be sung just as a regular kind of song. It's to be sung with zeal and with excitement and with energy, because you celebrate something and I celebrate something today that has changed forever. Resurrection plus empty tomb plus faith equals life eternal. That's a formula for Easter. Resurrection, empty tomb plus faith, believing, trusting, equals life eternal. May it be so for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's stand as we sing.